Hey guys. So, I made a movie, a video about my favorite TV and movies. I made that video a while ago, but someone so graciously reminded me that pick up where I left off, and although I might duplicate a couple of the answers to my favorite movies, I'm just going to give you a nice list that I drew up here, and with any luck, you guys will leave knowing a little bit more about me. Bit more about good movies I particularly enjoy. So, yeah, with any luck, you guys will be able to enjoy some new movies that you haven't heard about. It's what I enjoy about talking about things. I get feedback from you guys, and I get to learn some new things and topics and movies, in this case, to explore. And I hope you guys give me some good feedback, and it works both ways. Trying to find how long ago it was that I made my favorite movies, but let's see if I can find it. It was a while ago. It was a while back. For a part two, so I want to give you a part two. So there's my November 5th. November 5th was favorite TV shows. So maybe it wasn't that far back. August 26th, there it is, okay, ASMR 113, so it was episode 113 before I stopped putting the episode number in my movie, I keep saying that video title. This was called A Few Favorite Movies, and yeah, I guess I didn't put, I should have listed the movies, of course, in the description, but I'm probably going to repeat myself here, but let's get right into it. This is probably way too long of an intro. So the first one is definitely said The Never-Ending Story. So I won't elaborate on that. You can visit that episode. There's a slew of, what's his name, the director of, the departed Goodfellas Casino. What is his name? He's really, really good. Damn, I have to look it up. I'm usually pretty good. I guess it's too early for me right now. I try to do these before I go to work in the morning sometimes. Because I work second shift, so I can do this if I wake up early enough. Scorsese. Alright, Scorsese, that's who it is. Martin Scorsese. I might not have remembered that. But he... I'll knock out those three movies right away. I'm into good gangster movies. It's not exactly because of the violence, but the violence plays an integral role, certainly, in why I like it. It's a, movies are meant to be the most, like all good stories. You don't want to watch them if it's a mediocre tale. You want to go to the movies because it's an extraordinary tale. That's precisely why we like watching movies. So, they captivate us, they show us the extreme examples of what it's like to be a human being. Whether you're around murdering, suicide, any of our biggest fears, you know. But I think on top of that, you know, speaking in front of the public, like I just stuttered because I'm speaking to a camera. I can't genuinely imagine actually speaking to more than like 10 people that I didn't know. It's kind of off-putting. And it's the dialogue though, on top of that. Really makes it, if it's realistic, very witty dialogue, because in everyday conversation we always talk a lot of nonsense, and anyways, I think the Scorsese in The Departed, all three movies that I'm a fan of his, Goodfellas and Casino, he does an excellent job of streamlining the dialogue, and how do I explain it? It's very efficient, and it's witty, and it's something that you would be proud to have thought of. It's the peak of exchange of a good conversation between two people, I think. So it's like in the most precarious, crazy situation you could be in, the most witty, intelligent, or outlandish, entertaining dialogue you could think of. And that's what he does, you know, like the crazy twist, all three of them at the end of The Departed. and with some really good dialogue. I don't know, I didn't want to give too much away, but I enjoy very extreme cases of violence in my movies. I don't like horror movies, although you might think I would, based on what I just said. I think really I just like stories for what I think they're intended for, which is to convey what it's like to live at the most optimal level. And what I mean by that is precisely what I said, going out on a limb, taking chances, being intelligent, being aware of your surroundings, taking risks to offend people, and to the point of you getting murdered. I mean, that's what movies are. They're just extraordinary examples of crazy lives that are ultimately based in reality. So, The Godfather is another really, really efficiently edited, streamlined dialogue example. Example of that. Unlike what I'm doing right now. It's the exact opposite, really. The Godfather is, gives you an insight into immigration, street politics, government politics, family politics, international politics, when Michael goes to war, comes back, wins a medal, and how you, it conveys one possible way to deal with a father figure and an actual father, which I enjoyed because, you know, the family is such an important, thought, you know, it's gotta be a really stressful thing to be a father and be the head of your family, you know, in the traditional sense, and, you know when to discipline, know when to give your kids slack, let them learn for themselves, but know when to, also know when to put your foot down, you know. It's, I think The Godfather was a good example of all that, and knowing how to strategically play, politics between families, and at one point his son dies, and instead of retaliating, he knows the political, the wise move would be to meet up with all the family members, the heads of the five families, and sit down and respectfully, face to face, in a quiet, secure room, convey his desire for peace and no more bloodshed. So he takes the death of his oldest son and the attempt on his own life, for that matter, in stride, and he just accepts it, and shows his discipline and willpower and forethought to forego revenge for that act, and an attempt to bring peace and amicable relationships, and squash the violence between the families. So, and like the fact that he has moral values adds a whole different twist. It's like the Sopranos, like he's an evil dude who's killed plenty of people, but at the same time he's the protagonist of the movie. So you and a good movie, even if you have an evil character, they have redeeming qualities that are make you, it's kind of like a good way of conveying reality. There's no black and white. All of us have done something that we're not proud of, and the fact that in some way we're still redeemable, and we're not entirely evil or entirely good. It's a good example of, an extreme example of, just how blurry those lines can be sometimes. But he, going back to what I was getting to, is that he's approached the Godfather, Marlon Brando, and the Godfather is with a business deal that is very, very lucrative, potentially, but involves drugs. So he doesn't agree that drugs are a morally respectful or wise thing to become associated with and get involved with. He sticks to alcohol and gambling, which are two legal activities. And he has a bunch of politicians in his pocket, so he has to make that decision because they're coming to him because he has so much influence. And I think that's really interesting that he chooses to turn down a very, very financially lucrative offer, which ultimately causes an attempt on his life multiple times because of that. So he's fundamentally a character who's done some very evil deeds, killed some people, but they might not be evil because the people he's killed, all of them in the movie, at least the ones that I can remember, are genuinely, clearly, very, very clearly evil people. So I don't know, it's a very good character study of what it is to be actually good and powerful. Some next movies, I've already mentioned The Man from Earth, but if you haven't seen it, please, please, if you're interested in science fiction in any shape or form, watch that movie. It's so, so good. I think it's one of the best movies possibly ever made. From a production standpoint, it's almost looks like a B movie. But the screenplay that was written for it, the dialogue, was one of the most most captivating stories I've listened to in a while. It takes place in one house among a group of university professors that are holding a surprise farewell party for one of their colleagues, and it's at his house because he ducked out of the party that they had originally set up for him. The reasoning behind that is he travels. He leaves and creates a new identity every 10 years or so, because he is in fact a 14,000-year-old man and wants to conceal the fact that he does not age. So every 10 years when people start to notice that he doesn't age, he moves on. It's a cool premise, right? Well, the dialogue that covers what I just told you. It covers about the first maybe 10 minutes of the movie. And the next 2 hours after that is about as intelligent, at times kind of corny but funny jokes, witty witticisms. The dialogue is as inquisitive and thought-provoking as you would expect would actually come from a group of academicians, you know, people who spend their entire lives musing about the philosophy of spirituality of such a case. You have biologists, psychologists, philosopher, it's such a great, well-written script, and I think it just does such, it's exactly why, it's meant really to be a play, but obviously you could go see it and it would be just as good. But anyways, the Man from Earth, go see it. Into the Wild, I might have already mentioned that, so I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself, but that's just a good movie about adolescence and us finding our place in the world and realizing that ultimately the life that we grew up in is so, while family is extremely, extremely important, and they drive that point home, the writers, Sean Penn and John Krakauer, ultimately, I think the movie conveys the, you know, the wanderlust of being an adolescent, especially in modern times when we can, in America, most countries, or many countries, relative to previous ages, we have the ability to be as wealthy as we want to be, if we choose to pursue that. And it's kind of like what you do when you realize you're 18 or you're 22 and you've gotten your college degree and you have no clear direction in life and you don't know what what's going to give you the most meaning in life. So you travel skid hikes all around the U.S. for 2 solid years, completely alone, no money, just the money he earns as he goes, working on farms and McDonald's and stuff. And he meets more, it's a real story too, which is awesome, but ultimately he meets more welcoming, hospitable people than he does abrasive and unsociable people. So I think ultimately the point is that he's a better man for having met so many different people and having grew up in a very condescending and privileged and kind of pretentious family, and his ultimate realization at the very end of escaping that is that well, there's so much more to the world than his little family, but at the same time, happiness is only real when shared, and family is ultimately the single strongest unit that brings meaning to your life. So, thought that was a great message. Some other ones are The Hobbit, the first one. I like that one the most. It's just it wasn't exactly, what's the word? It didn't adhere. It wasn't as true to the story of the book, but I thought it was a great adaptation. The visuals were stunning. Story moved at a nice pace. I was obsessed with it. Just fall asleep to it, like for like 6 months in a row every night when it first came out. And I just like it. It's a good fantasy to get lost in. And Fight Club and American History X. I guess I'll lump those together. I mean, I really can't, honestly. Actually, Fight Club is, I hope you're not hearing my stomach so much, sorry. Fight Club is, well, they're both good philosophy. Fight Club is, like, it's kind of the same as Into the Wild. It's just about not having meaning in life, the nihilism that might occur from not having intimate relationships with anybody and working a very dismal, unsatisfying job that you have no personal stake in. And the rapid shift of meaning that can come from just stepping outside your comfort zone and meeting new people and ultimately doing crazy stuff, but nonetheless, that's the central theme, is to step outside your comfort zone and realize we're all scared little beings, and we don't want to be judged by the masses. That's why we all stay in line and wear the same shit and speak the same, and you know, it's can be overwhelming, but you can't completely dispense with that, because that's the glue that holds society together. nonetheless, you have to walk that fine line and define yourself, who you are, before you conform to what society is always peeking over your shoulder and telling you. American History X is a more specific example of conforming to the Nazi skinhead group, and how when Edward Norton and Edward, the other Edward, how their dad in the movie was killed by a couple black guys robbing a house, that created them, that caused them to manifest, direct their hatred towards all black people, and join a Nazi group who ultimately went out and actually committed crimes. And when he got sent to jail for curb stomping, I think he killed the guy, some black guy, who again was, I think, trying to rob his house. He had intimate contact with some black people in jail and made him completely alter his views of what it is to be a human being, and not just put a blanket statement of hatred on an entire group of people. So I thought that was great. To end this on I made it about halfway through the list, and hope you guys enjoyed it. I guess it was mostly about violence in movies, but I enjoy the philosophical bent. So let me know what your favorite movies are, and actually have about half of the rest of my list is comedies. So if you like comedies, then hopefully I'll make a part 3, but I won't guarantee it because I might not have a lot of other video topics on my to-do list. But I do listen to your feedback, so you guys ultimately decide what direction I take. Thanks for watching, and as always, sleep well.